The question over here is for the redox reaction, IO3 negative in aqueous medium plus manganese in a solid state, fine, and plus H2O, which gives us MnO4 negative in aqueous state plus I negative iodide ion in aqueous medium plus H positive in the aqueous medium. We need to actually talk about the correct coefficients of the iodate ion, H2O and H positive is what. So it's a redox reaction. We need to actually balance this reaction out. So before I do anything out, first of all, I'm going to actually talk about the reduction and oxidation half reaction. Then I'll talk about that, which is oxidizing agent and reducing agent. Then I'll talk about the end factor of oxidizing and reducing agent. Then I'll cross multiply the end factors. Then I'll balance the atoms other than hydrogen and oxygen. Then I'll balance oxygen via addition of H2O molecules to the oxygen deficient site. Then I'll balance H positive ions. I'll balance hydrogen atoms by the addition of H positive ions to the hydrogen deficient site. Afterwards, I will be balancing out the charges and then the result is in your hand. So over here, if I just talk about, it's IO3 negative changing into iodide ion basically. Talking about the oxidation number for iodine, let it be X. Minus 6. How come 6? 3 into minus 3. 3 into minus 2 basically. Why? Because we have 3 oxygen atom and minus 2 is the oxidation number of oxygen basically. So it is X minus 6 equals to minus 1. So X will be equals to plus 5. So the oxidation number of iodine in iodate ion is equals to plus 5 basically. And over here it's minus 1 in the product side. Okay. So it's changing from plus 5 to minus 1 basically. That means it's gain of electrons taking place. Gain of electron taking place. It is reduction half reaction. Reduction half reaction basically. Okay. Which means that iodate ion, IO3 negative ion, is an oxidizing agent which oxidizes the other species and itself gets reduced. Okay. If I talk about manganese, Mn, fine. So it's actually changing into MnO4 negative. Okay. Talking about the oxidation state of manganese, in reactant side, it is in zero oxidation state, whereas in the product side, it is, let it be X. Then it will be minus 8, 4 into minus 2, minus 2 the oxidation number of oxygen, which is equals to minus 1. So X is equals to plus 7. Okay, for manganese in MnO4 negative. So over here, it is in plus 7 oxidation state, wherein we are seeing that over here, loss of electrons is taking place. Loss of electrons. Okay, that means what can I say? What can I say that manganese is a reducing agent? Is manganese a reducing agent? Because reducing agent is the species which reduces the other species and itself get oxidized. So it is over here behave as a reducing agent. And this is oxidation half reaction. Oxidation half reaction. Wherein now if I just talk about the N factor. Okay, for reduction half reaction and oxidation half reaction. So for reduction half reaction and oxidation half reaction. If I talk about the N factor, so N factor is equals to mod of oxidation state of the product minus oxidation state of the reactant multiplied by the number of atoms in the reactant side for which we have calculated the oxidation state. The reduction half reaction is this one. This one is reduction half reaction. So it will be oxidation state of the product, which is minus 1, minus the oxidation state of the reactant, which is 5, okay, and multiplied by the number of atoms, okay, for which we have calculated the oxidation state, that too in the reactant site, which is iodine 1. So it is mod of minus 6, because minus 1 minus 6 into 1. So it becomes equals to 6 plus 6. Okay. Talking about the oxidation half reaction and the N factor. Okay. So that means N factor for the reducing agent manganese we are going to calculate out. So it will be the oxidation state of the product, which is 7, minus the oxidation state of the reactant multiplied by the N factor for the manganese. Okay. Because we are actually talking about the over here multiplied by the number of atoms basically. N factor is equals to mod of oxidation state of product minus oxidation state of reactant multiplied by the number of atoms in reactant side for which we have calculated the oxidation number. It is manganese and it is 1. So it is equals to plus 7. So we'll be cross multiplying the N factors. Okay, so when we cross multiply the N factors, so over here reduction half reaction is basically IO3 negative changing into iodide ion. So it's IO3 negative, which is changing into iodide ion. And over here, manganese is actually changing into MnO4 negative. Is it so? Yes, absolutely fine. So over here, I'm going to cross multiply the N factors. That too, first of all, in the reactant side only. So it will be 7 IO3 negative, okay, plus 6, not plus, wait a minute. It will be 7 IO3 negative, which is giving us iodide ion. And over here, it will be 6 manganese atoms, which is actually giving us MnO4 negative. Now, we'll be adding these two oxidation and reduction half reactions. So, it becomes 6 manganese plus 7 IO3 negative, which gives us basically iodide ion plus MnO4 negative. Now, we are going to balance the atoms other than oxygen and hydrogen. So, in the reactant side, we are actually having 6 manganese ions. So, in the product also, we will be writing 6 MnO4 negative. In the reactant side, we are having 7 iodine atoms. So, in the product also, we are going to write 7 iodide atoms. Okay. 7 iodide ions. Okay. Now, we are going to balance oxygen atom. We will be balancing oxygen atoms by the addition of water molecules through the oxygen deficient side. So, in the reactant side, we are having 7 threes are 21 oxygen atoms. Okay. Wherein, if I just talk about the product side, we are having 6 fours are 24 oxygen atoms. Okay, fine, no issues. So we'll be adding 3 water molecules, 3 H2O molecules to the reactant side in order to balance the oxygen atom. Now we are going to balance the hydrogen atoms, okay, by addition of H positive ion to hydrogen deficient side. So it's 3 2s are 6 over here. So we are going to add 6 H positive ions to the hydrogen deficient side. So the oxygen atoms and the hydrogen atoms, they are actually balanced. Now what we are going to talk about, any idea to anyone? Just let me know. Okay, so over here, the question actually asked us the correct coefficient of IO3 negative, H2O and H positive. Okay, for H positive, we have 6. For H2O, if I just talk about H2O, it's actually 3, H positive 6 and iodide ion is 7. Okay, but before that, let us balance the charges also. So over here, how many charges do we have? It is actually minus 7 charges we are having. Okay, fine. It's minus 7 and over here if I just talk about it is actually minus 7 minus 6 plus 6. Okay, 6 H positive, 6 MnO4 negative. So this cancels with this. So the charges are also balanced. So this is the balanced redox reaction for the equation given to us. Whereas if I talk about the coefficient for iodate ion, it is 7. For H2O, it is 3. And for H positive is 6. Option number C is the right and the best read answer for this particular question. Question over here is the most stable resonating structure among the given structures is. Okay, very good question. And I believe that you must be knowing the answer for this question. But yeah, I'll tell you. See, for a structure, okay, to be the most stable resonating structure, okay, there are some conditions basically. First of all, the compound should be neutral. Secondly, if the compound is not neutral, then it must possess maximum number of covalent bonds, because maximum number of covalent bond means maximum stability, which actually means that maximum number of atoms will have the octet complete. Okay, then I'll say the structure having less number of formal charges. Okay, cool. If the formal charges are there, now what to do? First of all, neutral. Second, maximum number of covalent bond. Third, minimum number of formal charges. But if the formal charges are there, then what should happen? There should be less separation of those formal charges. Okay, formal charges should be less separated. I mean to say, if positive and negative is there, so they should be closer to each other, not farther away from each other, and so on. So over here, if I just talk about, first of all, the neutral structure, neutral resonating structure, it's not there. Then I'll come to the counting of the number of covalent bonds. Okay, so if I just talk about the first resonating structure, number of covalent bonds, it's 1, it's 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So basically, you're having 7 covalent bonds. We are having 7 covalent bonds. 7 covalent bonds for the first resonating structure. Talking about the second resonating structure, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Again, 7 covalent bonds for the second resonating structure. Okay. If I just talk about the third resonating structure, so over here it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 covalent bonds. We are having 8 covalent bonds basically. Okay. Since we are having 8 covalent bonds, so I told you maximum number of covalent bonds means maximum stability of that resonating structure, because maximum number of atoms will have their octet completed. Since the question is asking most stable resonating structure among the given structures, so it's actually the third one. Third resonating structure. So I'll mark option number C is the right answer to this question. The question over here is, given resonating structures of phenol. So we just have a look on the resonating structures of the phenol. Okay. First, second, third, fourth, and fifth. Now let's see what the question is asking from us. We need to choose the correct order of stability of these structures, these resonating structures. We need to talk about the stability of these resonating structures. Okay, whenever we talk about the stability of resonating structures, first and foremost thing is that we look forward for the compound, that particular resonating structure, which is neutral, having no formal charges, okay, having maximum number of covalent bond. Because if the covalent bonds are maximum, it means maximum number of atoms have their octet completed. So we'll be looking for the neutral forms, neutral resonating forms of the phenol first of all. So over here it's the first and the fifth one. First and the fifth one having no formal charges. Talking about the number of covalent bonds, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 1 covalent bond between oxygen and hydrogen. So 11 covalent bonds. Same will be for the fifth resonating structure, 11 covalent bonds. Wherein if I talk about second, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Okay, again I can see that there are 11 covalent bonds. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 for this 11. Let me count it again. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Over here also we'll be having 11 covalent bonds again. If I talk about the fourth one, so it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 11. Okay, so all of these resonating structures do have 11 covalent bonds. So we cannot compare with the help of covalent bonds. Okay, how we are going to compare it then? First of all, we'll be actually looking for those resonating structures which are not having any of the formal charges and they are neutral form. So the neutral forms are 1 and 5th. So 1 and 5th, they'll be having the same stability. They'll be having the equal stability. Okay. Now, after 1 and 5th, what we are going to have the look upon for the resonating structures? Okay. So between 2nd, 3rd and 4th, what we are observing is just have a look very nicely. Just look these three resonating structures, second, third, and fourth, very nicely. I'm just rubbing all these covalent bonds are being drawn by me over here. Fine. What we are observing is, there is a rule while we are talking about the stability of resonating structures, that if we are having the formal charges, first of all, we look that the formal charges should be minimum. Formal charges should be minimum. Minimum number of formal charges. So over here we are seeing that the positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative. Okay, fine. Formal charges are same. But if there are formal charges, their separation should be, their separation should be less. Okay, the formal charges should be less separated. Unlike charges should be less separated in order to have the stability basically, okay, because the resonating structure will be approaching towards neutrality, the neutral form. So lesser is the separation between the unlike charges like positive and negative, more will be the stability of that particular resonating structure. In second and in fourth, what I'm seeing is that the positive charge and the negative charge, they are less separated. These unlike charges are closer to each other. Similarly, in fourth also, these unlike charges, they are closer to each other. So their stability will be same for second and fourth. The stability of these two resonating structures will be same. So second is equals to fourth basically. And the least stable is the third one, because over here the unlike charges are actually more separated. They are farther away from each other. So their stability, its stability, the resonating structure third, its stability, I'm saying it will be least. Okay, so this is basically the order, the stability order for the resonating structures given to us for phenol basically. And hence, I'll say it's 1 equals to 5th, 2nd equals to 4th, and the least one is 3rd. So, A is out of the lead because it's saying 2nd is least stable. If I talk about B, out of the race. If I talk about C, 1 is equals to 5th, 2nd is equals to 4th, and the 3rd one is least stable. Option number C is absolutely the right option for this particular question. So you'll be marking option number C as the right answer. Okay, the question over here is, the molecular diameters of A and B are 4 nanometer and 8 nanometer respectively. The pressure of A and B are 10 atm and 5 atm respectively. The temperature of A and B, they are 300 Kelvin and 400 Kelvin. The ratios of molecular mass of A and B is 30 to 40. What we have to find out? The ratio of binary collisions among A molecules to that of the B molecules. So we need to actually talk about the ratio of binary collisions between A and B molecules. And the molecular diameters of these two molecules, A and B, have been given to us as 4 nanometer and 8 nanometer. The molecular diameters, they are represented by the variable sigma basically. Pressure P of A is 10 and of B it's 5. Temperature of A, okay, A molecule is 300 Kelvin, whereas it's of B is 400 Kelvin. Molecular mass is in the ratio 30 to 40. We need to talk about the binary collisions. So, if I just talk about the formula for binary collisions, Z11, okay, it's basically Z and 1 and 1. It's actually the total number of binary collision. Okay. It's actually represented as total number of binary collisions, which is equals to 1 upon root 2. Okay. Then pi sigma square u average, average speed of the molecule. Okay. Multiplied by n star whole square. So this n star is number of molecules per unit volume. This is number of molecules. Number of molecules per unit volume, okay, wherein this U average is average speed of the molecules represented as under root of 8RT by pi M. Under root of 8RT by pi M, okay. Now we know one thing basically, that PV is equals to NRT, where n is number of moles, and yes, number of moles is also equal to n by na, where n is number of molecules and na is Avogadro number basically. So if I just write it down like this, that PV is equals to n upon na into RT. Okay, so over here I told you that n star is equals to number of molecules per unit volume. N is number of molecules. So talking about number of molecules per unit volume, number of molecules per unit volume, which is N by V, it will be equals to N by V will be equals to P into Na upon RT, P into Na upon RT, which is equals to basically N star. If I substitute the value of this N star, number of molecules per unit volume, in the formula of total number of binary collision, which is Z11. So it will be equals to, just have a look, Z11 is equals to 1 upon root 2. Okay, then it will be pi sigma square. What's the average speed of the molecules? Under root of 8RT by pi m. Okay, what is n star square? It is equals to p square n a square upon r square and t square. Absolutely fine. So what I can say is that total number of binary collision is directly proportional to sigma square multiplied by p pressure square divided by under root of m, and it's multiplied by t raised to power 3 by 2. Because over here it's t raised to power half. So when I'll take this t raised to power half in denominator, it will be t raised to power minus half. So t raised to power minus half multiplied by t square, it becomes t raised to power 3 by 2. Okay. So all other things, they are constant. Value of pi, constant. Root 2, constant. Root 8, constant. Root r, universal gas constant, constant. T temperature, constant. Pi again, constant. It's root m, which is actually having the variable values. T square having the variable values. T raised to power 3 by 2 having the variable values. Fine. Now, if we want to talk about the ratio of binary collisions among A molecule to that of the B molecule, so how we are going to represent it? So, just wait and watch. So, binary collision for A, okay, divided by or is to binary collision of B, okay. So, it will be sigma A upon sigma B whole square. Then it will be P A upon P B whole square. Then it will be under root of MB, molecular mass of B, divided by molecular mass of A. Then it will be TB upon TA raised to power 3 by 2. TB by TA raised to power 3 by 2, like this. So what's the molecular diameter, okay, of A and B? It's 4 and 8. Okay, 4 for A molecule and 8 for B. So it's 4 by 8 whole square. For the pressure, if I talk about, it's pressure of A is 10 and pressure of B is 5. So 10 by 5. 10 by 5. Okay. The ratio of their molecular masses have been given. For A, it's 30 and for B is 40. So for molecular mass of A and B, they're in the ratio 30 is to 40. So it will be basically 4 by 3 basically. Okay, fine. And for TB by TA, so it will be 400 and 300. Okay, so it is actually 400 by 300. Okay, raised to power 3 by 2. This is the thing. So it will be 4 ones and 4 twos are 8. 1 by 2 whole square, it will be 1 by 4. So it's 5 ones are 5 twos are 10. So multiplied by 4. So this cancels with this. Okay, so we are over here with, so it's 4 by 3. 3 by 2 plus 1 by 2. Because it's 3 by 2 and this root means power of half basically. So if I just talk about 3 by 2 plus 1 by 2, it is equals to 4 by 2, which is equals to 2. So over here we are with 1 by 4 multiplied by 4 multiplied by 4 by 3 whole square. 4 cancels with this 4 and hence it's 16 by 9. So this is our answer, 16 by 9. Option number C will be the right answer. So we can say that ratio of binary collisions among A molecules to that of the B molecule is equals to 16 by 9. The question over here is, which of the following resonating structures of naphthalene is most stable? So over here we are given with the three resonating structures of the naphthalene, and we need to talk about the most stable resonating structure of naphthalene. Okay, good. So over here, let me tell you, the most stable form of the bonds. Listen it very carefully. The most stable form of the bonds in the polycyclic compound is that arrangement in which the maximum number of the rings are in benzenoid form. I'm repeating it again. The most stable form of the bonds of polycyclic compound is that particular arrangement in which the maximum number of the rings are in benzenoid form. If I talk about 1, 2 and 3 resonating structure, it is the second resonating structure wherein we are having two rings in benzenoid form. See, this ring is also in benzenoid form and this particular ring is also in the benzenoid form. Whereas, if I talk about the first and second ring, there are only one ring which are in the benzenoid form. So, one and third, they are actually equally stable. But second is highly stable resonating structure because over here we are having two rings in benzenoid form. And in one and third, we are having one ring in benzenoid form. So, it is the second resonating structure of naphthalene, which is actually most stable. I think you've got this particular point. See, this is one benzenoid ring and this is the another benzenoid ring. You can just have a look. But over here, we are having only one benzenoid ring. Over here also, we are having one benzenoid ring. Okay. So, the most stable form of the bonds in the polycyclic compound is that particular arrangement, which is having the maximum number of rings in benzenoid form. So, it's option number, I'll say resonating structure 2. For naphthalene, which is highly stable, and yeah, one and third, they are equally stable, but not more stable than the second one. Option number B is the right answer to this particular question.